Everyone, let's all stand together, please.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you'd reign in me again. Lord, reign in me. Reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Over every thought, over every word, may my life reflect the beauty of my Lord. 'Cause you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me. Reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me. Reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again?
Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, Calvary. My name is Gavin. I'm going to be reading from 2 Peter, verses 8 through 13. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of the righteous.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
Let's all stand together.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Well, shine your light and let the whole world see
We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Oh, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. Please be seated.
You know, it's not often that people tell me they can't hear me. You know, we wanted to share with you a little bit about our trip to Japan. So you'll be hearing from three of us today, the three of us that went. We're also going to cook you dinner, a Japanese fare. So you can pick up also in the gym afterwards a report. It's got a lot of pictures from Dennis and Barbara and I of our trip, the places we ministered, the people we met. So be sure that you pick one of those up there on the tables. We were 9 hours north of Tokyo and 2 hours west to the coast. After the 9.0 magnitude earthquake, 500 miles of coastline was devastated in the country of Japan by three tsunami waves. The first one hit, 3-4 feet of water came in. People thought, oh, this is not a problem. They ran back into their homes. The second wave hit, destroyed homes, killed a lot of people. People went down to rescue those people. And the third wave hit, which was about 45 feet in height. So that's where a lot of the loss of life was, people going back into their homes. Because of the coastline, the hills and the mountains have like fingers that go down towards the beach. The waves came up and filled up to about 120 feet. You can see the sea line that has killed trees because of the salt water at about 120 feet. So damage was huge. 500,000 people were displaced. One-fifth of those were little children, 100,000 little children. That's dear to my heart. 135,000 homes were destroyed in the prefect that we were in. A prefecture, you'll see in the reports and you'll hear today, is like a state. So when you hear that term, you'll know that. People have gotten very creative in how they reach this country. So I wanted to share a couple things. There was a couple that we met the first day at the Den and Grace Church that we went to in Tokyo. And they used to be lounge singers, husband and wife. They weren't believers. They sang in a lounge in the Philippines. Our movies are a little bit behind times over there. They get them later than we do. And Sister Act came out. How you remember Sister Act? They did a gospel choir, took it to competition. That movie made a huge hit in Japan, and they were so intrigued by gospel music. They love music. They are well-trained in musical arts, and so this couple had come to Christ. They are very musically oriented, so they have started a class after church, and their church meets in a multi-purpose room. They teach gospel music, and they had about 30 people come to sing gospel. And they said, by the way, would you like us to tell you about the words that you're singing? So they get a chance to share the gospel. They take this group, along with groups all over the country, to a huge music festival. Last time they had 400 voices. And they bring a believing gospel singer to do the main guest appearance. And so that's a creative way that they're reaching people for Christ. You know, this was God's plan, not ours. We went to our last meeting just before we went to Japan thinking we were going to be tearing houses apart and, you know, working with our hands and getting real grubby, and God had other plans. You'll never guess what we were doing. We were cooking. Can you believe it? We were cooking. We were barbecuing. We did barbecues in each of the little settlements. And then at night, we would make hamburger patties and get them ready for the next day and make cookies. Now, one night we made 16 batches of cookies. in a toaster oven. This is Dennis's job. Okay, that was his job. He was to watch the cookies in the toaster oven while we mixed the next batch. There were six of us on our team. Dennis, Barbara, and I, we made up half the team. And two gals from Torrance area and a gentleman who was our team leader and translator from Oceanside. So God had a plan. We thought one thing and he planned the other. But it was a great opportunity to mix it up with people, to serve them. In the daytime while we were getting ready for the barbecue and getting the grill set up, we would go around to homes. We delivered rice. We delivered soap. They have to trek from these settlement camps down to the nearest store. They've got little stores in the community, but they have to haul everything. Remember, tidal waves take cars too, so there were piles and piles and piles of cars. So everything's gone. So we carried things for them that was heavy. We delivered 12-pound bags of rice. We delivered boxes of soap, electric blankets, clothes, and all that stuff. One day we had a surprise of a truck that came, and we unloaded box after box after box after box of futon pads, buckets, cleaning supplies, diapers, Depends, I guess that's both ends of the spectrum, and clothes and household goods and all kinds of things, water, tons of water. And that was a great gift from God to supply those things. I have no idea who it came from, but we were grateful to unload it and then help them distribute it. We went to a settlement that I'm sure you'll be hearing more about called Yamada, and we spoke to one woman. If I had to guess her age, I would guess around 60-ish, but she was probably younger than that. She had a tough time. She floated in the seawater for days until she was rescued. She has lung trouble and extremity trouble now because of the damage of the salt water and hypothermia. Remember, this hit in March. It's cold and snowy. I'm cold now, and it's not anywhere near that. They were looking at sub-zero temperatures. So there was a lot of impact from that. But she was grateful to be alive and grateful to have survived that. But harrowing stories. We heard of a gentleman who was in his truck, had gone to get painting supplies, and the last tsunami wave hit, and he basically rode it on his car. And he was young. He thought that was pretty fun. Me, I'm old. That was pretty foolish. But, you know, he was caught in that, but he survived. And so we were able to talk with him, or Phil was able to talk with him at McDonald's. We had a chance to talk with Carl Long. He teaches at Christian Academy in Japan, which was our first base in Tokyo. And we met him. We saw the school. We had lunch with him, actually, Barbara and Dennis and I did, and had a chance to catch up on him and Diane. And she's here in the States for surgery, so that was a nice thing to be able to pray with him and connect with him. We spent time at the beginning and the end of the trip with John Ouellette and got an update on him and the ministry, and were able to actually see what he does each day. So those are two Calvary missionaries that we were able to represent you, share with him how we're praying here as a church. It was neat to see their ministries as well. We were repeatedly struck with the humility and generosity of the people. They want to serve you. They want to give you a gift. They want to appreciate you in what you do for them. They're very grateful. You walk into a convenience store with a tag on that says, "I'm a volunteer," and they're like, "Thank you for helping my country." So they were very grateful. But we were also amazed that they are lost. Historically, less than 0.5% of the nation are believers. There's probably about 75 people here, so look around, check and see how many people are here. You would have to come in contact with or befriend 3 times the amount of people in this room. Look around, everybody. 3 times the amount of people in this room to even have the possibility of meeting a Christian in Japan. Okay, one more time. 3 times this population group to even have the possibility of meeting a believer, a born-again Christian in Japan. Wow, that's so different. You know, Christians are everywhere here. Some believers, some that just claim Christianity because they're Americans. But we're talking about a really lost people. They believe in anything that they can believe in and nothing. They believe in Shintoism to take care of the good things they do now. They believe in Buddhism, which takes care of the afterlife. And they believe in luck. They believe in rubbing this spirit. They believe in lighting this incense. And they believe in nothing. I don't know, it's just kind of all wrapped up into one mess. But they are lost people. So these creative ways of doing cafes, of working to create social relationships with them, is a way to reach them for Christ. We ended our trip with a half day of navigating the subways and traveling the trains with Japanese language signs. And we did some shopping. We saw a shrine and a temple and watched the worship that took place there by the people. We did some shopping and we went to the tallest building in Tokyo and saw the whole country by nightlight. So that was our touristy portion, about 3 or 4 hours worth. But you'll hear from Barbara about some of the people that we met, and you'll hear a little bit more later. But thank you for sending us. The funds that you sent, that you gave, were taken to buy soap, to buy laundry detergent, to buy blankets, to buy rice, and all the things that we could do. We bought hamburgers for the barbecues. We bought cookie supplies. Those were the things that we were able to do with your gifts. And so we appreciate you sending us. It was a fabulous opportunity to see through God's eyes of people that really need to love him and need to know him.
To praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship. Sound of your name, I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Nothing compares.
Nothing compares to the promise I have in
you. My favorite song. I told my husband I want that song at my funeral. going to Japan was an awesome experience. I cannot praise God enough for giving me that opportunity. It's so wonderful to be able to travel and to meet Christians all over the world and to see how they're working in ways that we just can't even imagine. And like Susie mentioned about Japan, how so few people are Christians. You know, they're very civilized. They bow a lot. They have a lot of traditions, a lot of customs. They have a very low crime rate. I'm sure you saw pictures of after the tsunami, how people would wait in line, leave their things, go home that night, come back the next day, and they would be in the same spot, and the things they had were just waiting there for them. So they're very, very kind to each other. But they are a nation that is lost. They're very self-reliant, and we know as Christians, we have to give up some of that self-reliance. We need to depend on God. So one of the things that really struck my mind there was people there that are working in Japan. Three I'd like to tell you about. The first one was a young man named Nathan, and Nathan has a family that lives in Hokkaido, Japan, which is really north, and he comes down once a week to help the people in the area where we were. And it's a 10-hour trip for him. He has to take a ferry to get to the main island of Honshu, and then he drives his car. And when we were there, we went to this little convenience store kind of out in the middle of nowhere. And somehow Nathan knew this lady that owned the convenience store, and she was having a grand reopening. And so Nathan was a music major, and she asked him to come and kind of do a little concert. So we went out there, and this day it was just Ro and Phil and I, and Susie and Dennis weren't with us. And so he set up his keyboard, and we set up some chairs, and he's thinking, okay, there's going to be like, you know, maybe 10, 15 people that are going to come here. Well, there was like 100 people that came, including some little kindergarten children. And Nathan had made a video about the tsunami, and with the song, "Won't You Pray for Me and I'll Pray for You," as the background, he showed this video. He played about five songs on the keyboard. One of them was "Jesus Loves Me." And he asked the people, how many know this song? Not one hand. Not one hand. And as we were there, there was kind of a young man, and he was studying to be a chef, and Phil, who was our team leader, started talking to him, and Phil was able to give him some literature about Jesus, and he took it, and I'm praying that he will read it. One of the other people that I came in contact with was Andy Carlson. And Andy is a young man whose family was, his mother and father were missionaries in Japan. And Andy's, I think, 23, 24 years old. And Andy was walking Japan and praying for Japan. And I just thought, what an unusual way for God to use somebody, but we know that the prayer is such an important part. Phil Waters, who was our team leader, was just an amazing man to me. He was so patient. I think I've never met anybody more patient than my husband, except Phil. And he was just a wonderful, wonderful testimony. And each in the morning when we were staying in this manufacturing building, I would wake up early. I don't know why, because I work nights, and so I usually sleep in. And I would get up about 5:30 or 6 o'clock, and I would go to the local McDonald's, which was about a half a mile or a mile from where we were staying. And I would go in and ask for some kohi, which of course is coffee. And then they told me, I like black coffee. Okay, now this is how you say black coffee. Remember Barack Obama, Baraku, black coffee. And I would never get it right. But I would go into McDonald's thinking I was gonna kinda have a little quiet time there, and there was Phil. And Phil was always talking to somebody. He met a young man there who was a social worker that was helping elderly people, and he would just engage with them and just, I mean, in such a short amount of time, have them talking about himself, and then he would turn it around to talking about Jesus. And he always had tracts and a little booklet in Japanese about salvation through Jesus. He was the one that met the man that rode out the tsunami in his tiny little Toyota truck. And Phil said, "Weren't you scared?" And he said, "No, it was fun. It was like a whirlpool." And then we saw this one man, and he was in this uniform. They have a lot of uniforms in Japan. And so we said to each other, "What do you think he is?" And I said, "I don't know. He looks like a crossing guard, you know." And so then he came in, and he just went right up to Phil, because Phil speaks, you know, fluent Japanese. And so then Phil says, "Oh, are you a crossing guard?" We were really embarrassed, because he worked for Nippon Steel, and he was saying how that during the what happened in New Orleans? Oh, the hurricane, that Nippon Steel had sent a lot of steel over to New Orleans, and he had been there. But I mean, he was just so excited to meet Phil, and he asked for his card and everything, and I'm sure he heard from him. And Phil was just constantly handing out those little brochures and pamphlets that he had in Japanese. There was a couple that stayed with us in this kind of big building. Their name was the Hamas. Mr. Hama had quit his job so that he could work full-time in relief and ministry. While we were in Japan, we went to a church in Morioka, and I met a couple there. The wife is a nurse. She works on a mental health unit, and I praise her for that. Something I could never do. And I received an email from him, and I wanted to read it to you. He said, "Thank you for coming to Japan and to help us." And we heard that everywhere, as Susie had said. They had gone to one of the relocation centers that we had been to, and he said that about 20 people came, they sang songs, and they gave, you know, them coffee and cookies. And he said, "Now is the time to talk about Jesus, because they don't have too much prejudice against Christians right now. Two women received Jesus already." Yes, praise God. And I wrote him back and I said, "I'm going to meet those ladies in heaven." And one man came to our church meeting in Morioka, which is a two-hour drive from the area. He said, "I'm really excited about what God is doing here." And then he also met a man who lost half of the neighborhood around him. He said he was very lonely because his neighbors weren't there anymore, and he's asked him to come and stay with him several times. And he said, "Please pray for this man, that he will receive Jesus as his Savior." And so it was just a wonderful trip. Like I said, I can't praise God enough. I just think about how the Japanese civilization is right now. I mean, how they're just so proper. Everything's just, you know, kind of in order. But they're just people that need the Lord. And so my prayer for them is that God will raise people. When we were in Morioka, I told them, I said, "You know, your country just reminds me of the verse, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." And so please pray for that in Japan. Thank you.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family. valley, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, prosperity. We pray your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. And love is way too much to give us lesser things. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights is what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry out in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while, you hear each desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to believe. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights is what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart. This is not our home. This not our home. What if your blessings come through raindrops and your mercy comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? What if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest night, are your mercies in disguise?
Well, what we're hearing in this week are reminders of God's many, many mercies and his blessings. May we be a thankful people and a people invested in the things that matter to him. We'll ask the ushers to come forward at this time, and we're going to worship the Lord with the giving of our tithes and offerings. And as we give, we'll ask the children to be dismissed to their own special time of children's church. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what we've been hearing, for evidence of your work, even through very, very difficult times. We pray, Father, that you would find us investing our lives, the lives that you give us, in the things that matter for all eternity. I thank you, Lord, that we can give now at this wonderful time of year, giving thanks. Thanks that we can give. We pray that you would use all of our gifts, our tithes and offerings, that Jesus might be magnified. We pray this in his name. Amen. The children can be dismissed out the doors. Mrs. Plug is going to take them now at this time.
Rejoice, rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts. He lives, his breath is in you. Arise, a mighty army, we arise. Now is the time for us to march upon the land into our hands. He will give the ground we claim. He rides in majesty to lead us into victory. The world shall see that Christ is Lord. Rejoice, rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts. He lives, his breath is in you. Arise, a mighty army, we arise. God is at work in us, his purpose to perform, building a kingdom of power, not of words. Where things impossible by faith shall be made possible. Let's give the glory to him now. Rejoice, rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts. He lives, his breath is in you. Arise, a mighty army, we arise. Though we are weak, his grace is everything we need. We're made of clay, but this treasure is within. He turns our weaknesses into his opportunities, so that the glory goes to him. Rejoice, rejoice, Christ is in you, the hope of glory in our hearts. He lives, his breath is in you. Arise, a mighty army, we arise.